Welcome to Health Mantra. The topic of discussion is bronchial asthma. Introduction. Asthma is a clinical syndrome. The syndrome meaning is it's a group of symptoms which consistently occur together. Asthma is characterized by airway obstruction which is partially or completely reversible, either spontaneously or with treatment. There is an inflammation in the airway that's the leading to excessive narrowing with consequent reduced airflow and symptomatic wheezing and dyspnea. Narrowing of the airway is usually reversible, but in some patients with chronic asthma, there may be an element of irreversible airway obstruction. If we see the prevalence meaning the proportion of particular populations found to be affected by medical condition at specific time. Now, prevalence of asthma is its most common chronic disease globally. Approximately 300 million people affected. Now appears to have stabilized with 10 to 12% of adults and 15% of children affected by the disease. Etiology of asthma. It is a heterogeneous disease with interplay between genetic and environmental factors. The meaning of heterogeneous is it's a consisting of parts or things that are very different from each other. The endogenous factors that are genetic predisposition, atopy meaning genetic tendency to develop the classical energy, airway hyperresponsiveness, and gender, males are more affected. Environmental factors, indoor allergens, outdoor allergens, occupational sensitizer, passive smoking, and respiratory infections. If we talk more about atopic and non-atopic asthma, then atopy is a major risk factor for asthma, and non-atopy individuals have very low risk factors to develop asthma. Patients with asthma commonly suffers from other atopic disease like allergic rhinitis and atopic dermatitis. The atopy is due to genetically determined production of specific IgE antibody, which patients may have a family history of allergic disease. The allergens that leads to sensitization are usually protein that have a protease activity. The commonest allergens are house nuts, mites, cat and dog fur, cockroaches, grass, and tree pollens. The intrinsic asthma, that is non-atopic asthma, it's a negative skin test and they have a normal serum IgE level. They have adult in onset and commonly they have symptoms like nasal polyps and may have aspirin sensitivity. They usually have more severe and persistent asthma. Most common triggers for asthma are allergens, upper respiratory tract infection, exercise and hyperventilation, cold air, sulfur dioxide, drugs like beta blockers and aspirin, steroids, and irritants like household spray and paint fumes. The classical pathological findings for asthma will be persistent airway inflammation, bronchial hyperactivity, and subsequent airflow obstruction. When inflammation and bronchial hyperactivity is present, asthma can be triggered by additional factors too, as mentioned earlier. When patient inhales an allergen which he or she is sensitized, the antigen cross-links to specific IgE molecule attached to the surface of mast cells, and bronchial mucosa and submucosa will be activated. The mast cell deregulate rapidly and release the multiple mediators like leukotrienes, histamine, prostaglandins, platelet activating factors, and other mediators. These mediators lead to smooth muscle contraction, vascular congestion, and leakage, resulting in airflow obstruction. Clinical features of asthma. The characteristic symptoms of asthma are wheezing, dyspnea, coughing, which are variable both spontaneous and with therapy. Symptoms may be worse at night, and patients typically awake in early morning hours. Patient may report difficulty in filling their lungs with air. There is increased mucus production in some patients with typically tenacious mucus that is difficult to expectorate. There may be increased ventilation and use of accessory muscles of ventilation. Prodromal symptoms may be precede an attack with itching under the chin, discomfort between the scapulae, or inexplicable fear that is impending doom. Physical signs of asthma. Typical physical signs are inspiratory and to great extent expiratory. bronchi throughout the chest. There may be hyperinflation. Some patients, particularly children, may present with predominant non-productive cough, that is known as cough variant asthma. There may be no abnormal physical findings when asthma is under control. Now, if you look at the diagnosis, first pulmonary function test, there will be airflow limitations with reduced FEV1 by FVC ratio and reduction in peak expiratory flow rate. Reversibility is demonstrated by greater than 12% or 200 ml increased in FEV1 or 15 minutes after an inhaled short acting beta 2 agonist, or in some patients by 2 to 4 weeks trial of oral glucocorticoids. Another tool, airway hyperresponsiveness, it can be measured by methacholine or histamine challenge with calculation of the proactive concentration that reduces the FEV1 by 20%. Hematological test, there will be total serum IgE and specific IgE to inhaled allergens may be measured in some patients. Imaging, chest X-ray usually normal but may show hyperinflated lungs in more severe patients. In exacerbation, there may be evidence of pneumothorax. Lung shadowing usually indicates pneumonia or eosinophilic infiltrates in patients with bronchopulmonary aspergillosis. High resolution CT scan may show areas of bronchiectasis in patients with severe asthma, and there may be thickening of bronchial walls, but these changes are not diagnostic factors for asthma. Skin test. Usually skin prick test to common inhalant allergens are positive in allergic asthma and negative in intrinsic asthma. But these tests are not useful in diagnosis, but it can be used for persuading patients to undertake an allergen avoidance measures. Now if we look at the management of asthma, the aims for asthma therapy will be minimal chronic symptoms including nocturnal, minimal exacerbation, no emergency visits, minimal use of as required beta 2 agonist, no limitations on activities including exercise, peak expiratory flow rate, sericardian variation should be less than 20%, near normal peak expiratory flow rate, and minimal adverse effect from medicine. Medication used for asthma, the main drug, it's a bronchodilator. It gives a rapid relief with relaxing airway smooth muscles and also controls which inhibits the underlying inflammatory process. The common used bronchodilators are beta 2 adrenergic agonist, anticholinergics and theophylline. The control therapies are inhaled corticosteroids, systemic steroids, chromonants, anti-IgE therapy, and some alternative therapies are hypnosis, acupuncture, breathing control, yoga, chiropractic and splenotherapy. And educations. The most of the day-to-day responsibility for managing asthma falls on patients and the patient's family. Patient education is a powerful motivational tool, helping the patients to attain the skills and gain the confidence to control the asthma. The patient education involves the helping the patient understand the asthma and learning the practicing the skills necessary to manage it. Patient education includes providing information and developing a partnership with the patients, involving the patients in a decision making and demonstrating and observing the asthma management practice, such as the proper use of inhaler, nebulizer and peak flow meters. Physiotherapy management for asthma. The first, the breathing exercise, the relaxed diaphragmatic breathing. It improves the efficiency of breathing, reduces the drug use and asthma attack, and can be progressed to unsupported sitting or standing. Some evidence also says Buteyko technique is useful. It reduces the minute ventilation by slowing the respiratory rate with breathing counting and using the distraction by rocking and walking. And at night, lying on the left side and tapping on the mouth closed. The rationale behind this, it reduces the hyperventilation. The exercise training in asthma. Asthma and exercise have a strange relationship. Exercise can trigger an acute episodes, but the aerobic training with appropriate precautions has shown the following outcomes. It reduces the exercise-induced asthma, improves the conditioning, improves the confidence and independence, and reduces the asthmatic attacks. Outdoor exercise is best taken in the least polluted areas and time of the day. Face masks protected against the some pollutions, but the filters must be changed regularly. Muscle tension and habitually hyperinflated chest are occasionally evident, for which postural advice and emphasis on exhalation are indicated. Exhalation is not to be encouraged during the acute episodes when hyperinflation is necessary to hold open obstructing airway. It has been claimed that the inspiratory muscle can be damaged during an attack and that the risk is reduced by strengthening these muscles. 6 months of inspiratory muscle training using a pressure threshold device for 30 minutes 5 days a week reduces the symptoms, medications use, and hospitalizations. Cuffing can relieve or exacerbate the asthma, and physiotherapists can advise on effective cuffing or cuff suppressions or both. Other physical measures for asthma. Relaxation is well established as a therapy for asthma and highly valued by patients. Techniques that achieve profound relaxation have shown positive outcomes, especially meditation, yoga, and hypnotherapy. Acupuncture can increase the peak expiratory flow as well as decrease the use of medications. The naturopathic assessment technique may indicate a need of supplementary vitamin C and antioxidant, or use of food exclusion diet to identify certain additives and allergens. Some of the useful strategies for patients: sit upright or lean slightly forward, resting on the arms or on a table, or sit astride a chair backwards with arm resting on a chair's back. Keep warm. Sit near the fresh air but not the cold. Take sips of warm water. Some patients may prefer cold, but this should be not attempted in bad attacks. Breathe through the nose unless the breathlessness makes this impossible. If there is a dizziness and tingling with hand and feet, breathing is faster than it needs to be. This can reassure the indirectly help the slow down the breathing. Practice previously learned techniques of relaxation, abdominal breathing, and control over a breathing. This should be started at the first intimation of acute episodes. The innocent techniques to raise the resting lung volume may help to open the narrow airways. Extra elastic work imposed by hyperinflation is offset by less airflow resistance, so that total workload is reduced. Some patients will have already achieved optimal inflations spontaneously. There are some benefits from rhythmic slow chest percussions to improve, promote relaxation. Other techniques to reduce the work of breathing are like the positionings, energy conservation techniques, and patient can be used. Mucus may be present with slow onset of attack, in which the case slow percussion can both promote the relaxation as well as clear the secretions. If secretions are too thick, warm humidifications with normal saline may be indicated, but this can be increased airflow resistance in children or those with severe airway obstructions, and close observation of saturation is required. Patients who continue to tire may need to rehydration and mechanical assistance. Low to mid volume of CPAP will relieve the inspiratory muscles from their exhausting work of breathing. If CPAP is not available, IPPB or non-invasive ventilation can be used to ease the work of breathing. Thank you for listening. Kindly like, share, and subscribe Health Mantra.